Welcome to Mayo Clinic Sleep Medicine Podcasts, a series for physicians, advanced practice providers, nurses, and other health practitioners treating sleep disorders or interested in learning about state-of-the-art advances in sleep medicine and sleep health. I'm your host, Dr. Michael Silber.
And I'm your co-host, Dr. Maitri Juna. We are both consultants at the Center for Sleep Medicine at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. Thank you all for joining us for today's podcast, which is part two of our discussion on violence in sleep. Reports of court cases in which defense attorneys claim that acts of violence, including homicide, have occurred while the accused is sleepwalking, generate considerable public interest. But can this really occur? To continue our discussion of violence in sleep, my guest today is Dr. Michael Silber, professor of neurology and a board-certified sleep specialist at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. Mike, thank you for joining us today. One of the most famous cases is that of Ken Parks, who in 1987 was accused of killing his mother-in-law. Can you tell us a little bit more about this case?
Yes, certainly, Maitri. This is a fascinating story, which is written up in the journal Sleep, and anyone can read the more of the details by looking back at that article. So, Kenneth Parks was a 23-year-old Canadian electronics worker who developed a gambling addiction that led to him embezzling money from work. This was discovered. Ken was fired and charged with theft. As you can imagine, this caused considerable stress, marital discord, and severe insomnia, exacerbated by the fact that he had a 5-month-old daughter. Now, he planned to visit his parents-in-law on Sunday, May 24th, 1987, to inform them about his legal and financial problems. His relationship with them had been really excellent. His mother-in-law is reported to have called him my gentle giant. So you can imagine the stress he was under to tell them the legal trouble he was in. So the day before, on that Saturday afternoon, he played a strenuous game of rugby and then watched a TV program with several violent episodes. He didn't consume alcohol or any drugs, but at about 1:30 a.m. on that Saturday night, he fell asleep on the couch. His next recollection was seeing his mother-in-law. He became aware he was in a different house and had a knife in his hand. He left the house, climbed into his car, which seemed to have been there, and drove to a police station where he was found to be in a confused state, saying he thought he may have killed some people. He had severe knife injuries to his hands with severed tendons, but didn't seem to be aware of this and didn't seem to be in any pain at all. It transpired he had driven 14 miles to his parents-in-law's home, let himself in with a key that he apparently possessed, strangled his father-in-law, who was left unconscious, and beat his mother-in-law to death after stabbing her several times with one of her own kitchen knives. It was later estimated that the entire event, including the driving, may have lasted not more than 25 to 30 minutes. Throughout the medical and legal proceedings that followed, Ken appeared deeply shocked, remorseful. He told a consistent story that he remembered little of the events. No motive was ever found for conscious homicide. He was on great terms with his parents-in-law. He was due to visit them the next day to explain what had happened to him. No one ever found any motive of why he would want to kill them. Ken had sleepwalked since childhood. And on one occasion, a brother had prevented him from jumping out of a window during episodes, just as we discussed about other patients in the last podcast. While waiting trial, two of his cellmates reported brief episodes when he would sit up in bed, mumbling and confused. There was also a strong family history of sleepwalking. Well, the principal sleep expert who testified for the defense was the Canadian neurologist Dr. Roger Broughton. Now, Dr. Broughton is actually the first person to understand sleepwalking as a disorder of arousal. He gave it the name. He published a seminal paper in the 1960s on this, and that's been the concept of sleepwalking ever since, that the problem is not sleep, but a disturbance in the arousal mechanism, whereas most of us can arouse fairly easily from slow wave sleep, people prone to sleepwalking get sort of, if I can put it this way, locked in a confused, dissociated state halfway between wake and sleepy and sleep and slow wave sleep. And that was Dr. Broughton's major contribution to the understanding of sleepwalking. So he was asked to see the person by the defense attorneys. And the defense's explanation of events was that they took place during a prolonged episode of behavioral automatism, during which he actually drove to his parents-in-law's house. It was postulated that the violence occurred when they discovered an intruder came down and tried to restrain him. Ken's long history of past sleepwalking was considered important. Factors that might have precipitated a prolonged and complex episode of sleepwalking that night included sleep deprivation with the severe stress, the physical activity. Remember, he played rugby that Saturday afternoon that might have resulted in deeper than usual slow wave sleep. And of course, the sort of subconscious awareness of the stress for the next day when he was going to visit his parents-in-law, and that might have come up and surfaced in his mind. Now, there was some skepticism you could really drive all that way in sleep, but there have been other reports of sleep driving. It's not totally unheard of by any means. Driving's a sort of overlearned skill, and if there's not a lot of obstructions or traffic on the road, complex motor activities can occur in a dissociated state of sort of partial consciousness. Well, anyone listening to this podcast, no doubt you're formulating in your own minds what the outcome was. And the outcome was that the jury acquitted Ken Parks of murder. They acquitted him of attempted murder. The judge found he was not a danger to society, as this was a once-only episode and he'd not shown violence during sleep under other circumstances, and he was released. And that's really the end of that story. I must say, having reviewed the case, all the details I can find about it, I would agree with most experts who've considered the case and found the defense's conclusion and the verdict to be correct. But certainly quite a striking story.
Very much indeed. And another even more troubling case is the 1997 Arizona homicide in which Scott Falater was accused of murdering his wife. I think our listeners would also be interested in hearing this perplexing story. Could you please tell us about this, Mike?
Yes, this case is especially remarkable as the medical expert witnesses, both sleep specialists for the prosecution and the defense, have published separate accounts of the case with very different interpretations and explanations. Dr. Mark Pressman, who is a psychologist, a sleep specialist, and a professor at Thomas Jefferson University in Philadelphia, has extensive experience in the forensic aspects of sleep disorders, and he's actually published the authoritative textbook on criminal behavior and scientific evidence in cases of sleepwalking. And I would say any sleep specialist who takes these cases on and wishes to get involved, I think it's a definite must reading to read Dr. Pressman's book. Anyway, Dr. Pressman was hired by the prosecution, and he testified in support of the prosecution. Testifying for the defense was Dr. Rosalind Cartwright, also a psychologist, a prominent sleep researcher from the Rush University in Chicago. She passed away 3 years ago at the age of 99, quite a remarkable person, and she testified in support of the defense. So what was the story? Scott Falater was a married electrical engineer and project manager in Arizona. He was supervising a new project that he had begun to believe was unlikely to be successful. As a result, he developed severe stress, exhaustion, and insomnia. He was reported to be sleeping only 2 to 4 hours a night. Dr. Cartwright's account describes him as having, quote, a close and loving family without financial, health, or marital difficulties. The prosecution, on the other hand, raised possible marital difficulties over religious conflicts and whether the couple should have further children. But, you know, reading both accounts and everything I've read about the case, the overall perception seemed to be that there was no serious marital problems between them. So, on the evening of January 16th, 1997, Mr. Falater was asked by his wife to check the swimming pool filter pump of their pool that was malfunctioning. He started to repair it at 9 p.m., but it soon became too dark, and he went to bed at about 10 p.m., first changing into pajamas. He reported no further recollection of events until police entered his house later that night. Sometime within an hour of going to bed at 10 p.m., he had dressed himself, obtained a flashlight and a knife, and walked to the swimming pool. His wife appeared to have heard him and followed him there, where he stabbed her 44 times. He then placed his bloody jeans and other clothes, together with the knife, into a Tupperware container in his garage, put the container in a black plastic bag, and placed it in the spare tire well of his car. He seems to have then returned to the house, changed again into pajamas, and cleaned and bandaged a cut on his finger. He then put on heavy work gloves, walked back to the swimming pool, and was observed by his next-door neighbor that he dragged his wife's body into the swimming pool and seemed to be holding her head under the water. He then placed the wet gloves in another plastic bag in the spare tire well of the car where he'd placed the previous objects. He next remembered hearing voices in his house, ran down the stairs, and was arrested by the police. He appeared confused about the events when interrogated at the police station later in the night. At the trial, the defense contended that the events had occurred during a period of complex sleepwalking. Well, let's start with Dr. Pressman's testimony for the prosecution. He provides in his account of the case a detailed and reasoned explanation why there is doubt surrounding this hypothesis. And these are the things he said were incompatible with sleepwalking. It's highly unusual for sleepwalkers to dress themselves and to be aware they need to use a flashlight in the dark. His actions in putting away the bloody clothes, the knife, and later in a separate episode, the heavy gloves he'd worn when he pulled his wife into the swimming pool, appeared to be conscious behaviors aimed at concealing the crime. His bandaging of his injured finger, changing back into pajamas, returning to the pool, using those heavy gloves, seemed to Dr. Pressman also to be goal-directed and not the sort of behaviors that you could explain in a semi-conscious dissociated state. Well, what did Dr. Cartwright say? Well, she noted that family and friends related that Mr. Falater had had a history of childhood sleepwalking, including a violent sleepwalking episode in elementary school. He had a history of six relatives who also sleepwalked. He had no previous history of daytime violence of any sort. And remember, he stabbed his wife 44 times. And his marriage appeared to be loving with no discernible motive for a severe and violent murder. He'd been under extreme stress at the time with sleep deprivation, and we know those are both factors which can precipitate sleepwalking in someone who's predisposed to it. The event occurred within an hour of going to sleep, which of course is when most sleep stage N3 sleep, slow wave sleep occurs, which is the stage out of which sleepwalking occurs. The defense explained his actions during the event as automatic behaviors. They suggested his sleeping brain said he should continue to repair the swimming pool, that he had tried to repair until it got dark and he went back to the swimming pool. And they say he'd stowed similar objects in that trunk in the same place when he went on camping trips, so his brain would have sort of known that's the way to place to put objects. They postulated that his wife had come to the pool, seeing her husband there. Whatever is he doing in the middle of the night trying to repair the pool? Tried to restrain him, perhaps, and he became violent with unpremeditated, involuntary violence. He reported amnesia and confusion later in the night that was seen in the police interrogation. So they argued this was all an arousal parasomnia. Well, again, I'm sure people listening to this podcast are making their own minds up of what the conclusion was. Well, the Arizona jury found Mr. Falater guilty of first-degree murder, and he was sentenced to life in prison. Appeals failed, and he is currently serving a life sentence. Now, I have to finish this story with something a little embarrassing. Many, many years ago, when I was a lot younger, I heard Dr. Cartwright talk about the case and watched a video she showed of the interrogation in the police station, and he certainly sounded to me to be genuinely confused. I was very influenced by this presentation when a couple of years later, still when I was much, much younger earlier in my career, I gave a talk on sleepwalking before a national audience. Without any personal involvement in the case at all, I rashly gave my opinion that the verdict was a miscarriage of justice. A member of the audience, who I believe must have been Dr. Pressman, but I can't be sure, I've never asked him, jumped up in the middle of my talk and said, "I was the expert witness for the prosecution, and you're quite unaware of many facts," which was, of course, entirely true. I was unaware of many facts. I just answered, "Well, thank you so much. I'd be happy to talk with you afterwards about it." And I did. But as you could imagine, it was very embarrassing. And I certainly learned a lesson. Be very careful of what you say, unless you are very sure you know all the facts of cases you're discussing. Well, I have been over this case several times since then, thinking about it all, though of course I was never involved. And I have to say that today, as I talk to you, I'm still uncertain whether Mr. Falater was guilty or not. It's likely we will never know.
Those are two very interesting cases, Mike. Thank you for sharing those with us today. Are there any final messages that you would like to leave with our listeners?
Well, again, I would say that cases of severe violence and homicide during sleepwalking are exceptionally rare, very complex, as certainly these cases have shown. And I think for sleep specialists, please, my advice would be to leave them to experts who've had considerable experience in forensic sleep medicine. If you are going to get involved in these cases, read the literature on it. I'd certainly recommend reading Dr. Pressman's book, and be aware there are very difficult issues involved, and it will certainly take you out of the realm of just pure medicine and your relationship to patients into what may be a very foreign realm of forensic science. But these are important cases to be at least aware of, because every sleep specialist, especially those dealing with parasomnias, may come across this occasionally in their career. As we discussed in the first podcast, violence during REM sleep behavior disorder, although not leading to homicide, is very common, and every sleep specialist who deals with parasomnias must be aware of this and how to try prevent and manage it. So thank you for inviting me to talk on this really very interesting and sometimes very disturbing topic.
Much appreciate you sharing your expertise today as well, Mike, and to our listeners for joining us today.
We hope you enjoyed this podcast. If so, please tune in again through wherever you receive your podcasts as we discuss further topics in sleep medicine and sleep health. Thank you.